systems and talk about the future and where they're going. Is there any advice you have from sharing on that? And someone also asked, is there a percentage or a number of how many Muslims maybe are converting to Christianity in a country or the Middle East? I don't know. It's a tough question.
Let's start with the second one first, because the first one would maybe take a little bit more time to delve into. I don't know of any specific statistics or things of that nature. A lot of that, the reason behind that is because it's really hard to know that information. And when you, those who are in a position to know that information, they're concerned with the security of converts. And so it's not widely known. It's not published. It's not, so it's more kind of on a story-by-story basis rather than specific numbers and percentages that are being thrown out there. I will say this, though, from all kinds of confirmed and credible resources, independent, that confirm each other, there is a high number of, and one of the things we talked about last night, is more Muslims coming to faith in the last 20 years than in the last 1,200 years combined. A lot of that has to do with the fact that there is a lot more evangelistic missions efforts among the Arab Islamic world. But it's also, that's just a testament to that God is at work, and the Spirit is at work in the Middle East. We talked about dreams and visions as a method that seems to be commonly used, just independent testimony after testimony after testimony of Muslims who came to Christ because they had a dream or vision about Christ, and then that led them to the Bible, or it led them to another believer who shared the gospel with them. And there's many testimonies that I could share of Muslims I've met, former Muslims, believers who I've met that came to faith through dreams and visions. Iran is one of the fastest growing underground churches in the world today. You may have known that, you may not have known that, but in the nation of Iran is one of the fastest growing underground churches. More conversions to Christ, and the underground church is growing. In fact, I've got the opportunity this coming May to travel not to Iran, but to Turkey, to do a pastor's training conference with pastors from Iran who are coming out of Iran to do pastor's training and missions and evangelism and other things. But because they're just seeing that the church is just growing so much. So exact numbers or percentages of where that's taking place, I don't know, and I couldn't give an exact number on that. There are some more than others. Like Iran, there's a much higher percentage than there are, for instance, in the Arabian Peninsula, Saudi Arabia, Yemen, those places. It's still very, very difficult, but honestly, there are reports of the church growing and people coming to faith in Christ. As to the first question you asked, how can we use the doctrine of heaven and hell, and maybe their perspective on that, to be a bridge, to share the gospel, right? See, that's huge, and that's what I'd love to talk about some more today before we go, is how specifically can we be a good witness? And I think that's one way to engage in a conversation, to get to the spiritual conversation with a Muslim, is because they do believe in a heaven and a hell. They just don't understand salvation like we understand it. And so that can be a great starting point. And I think, as Dr. Christian just said just a minute ago, they go to bed not knowing whether they've done enough, not knowing whether or not God would receive them if they died right then. And that is a great way to say, listen, tell me about that. What is your expectation? And if you're honest, they're going to say, well, I just don't know. Or they may just say, I know I'm not good enough. Or at least they would say, I don't know. Who can know? Not even Muhammad knew whether he would go to paradise. How could I know? And then that's a great platform for us to be able to jump right aboard and say, I'm so sorry. Let me share with you some good news, though. I do know, and here's why. Jesus gave us eternal life secure and steadfast because it's not based upon it. It's based upon the cross and his death and resurrection, and he calls us to just trust in him. And then as a result of that we are secured in that. And you can spend some time from there going into some scriptures about that. But I think that's one of the best places and easiest ways to start a conversation, to get to that spiritual conversation. It's just to ask a simple question like that. Hey, what do you think? Do you feel like you'll get to go to heaven or paradise when you die? Tell me a little bit about it. Does that concern you? Do you have questions about that or something? And then it can be a great springboard into sharing the gospel.
So. I have something to add. I don't know if it's a statement or what, but I find out from you if this seems to be true or you perceive it as well. But in the past, 8 years, the 24-hour news cycle has been pretty horrendous. In the sense that, tend to get it pounded into us, and if we spend any time in front of the TV, Debbie and some others are talking about that, you know, our perceptions tend to get in the way of what, you know, God's will is for our life. It's like Romans 12:2, it tells us to be, you know, transformed by the renewing of our minds. Do you find that this 24-hour news cycle seems to be a large culprit in the people's perceptions of the Middle East and the Islamic people? And is it wrong?
Absolutely. It's a major influencer in our culture because of the because of 24-hour news feed, you called it, and then social media, and then just how saturated we can be with, and inundated we can be with opinions after opinions after opinions. And it can be thrown out there and just so easily accessible now. You don't have to wait even until 5 o'clock to sit down and turn on the TV. You can just pull it up on your phone, type it up on the internet at work, anything, and you can just get an immediate, you can read article after article if you've got spare time. And the bad part about that is that you're obviously, what we get comes from the perspective of who's writing. And so if we listen to the same people and the same things, if they're good, then that's great and that can be helpful. But a lot of times, even if they're not entirely wrong, a lot of times they're still a little one-sided. And so what they do is they get us thinking on a path that then the next day we go a little further on that path. And then the next day we go a little further on that path. And then we realize that months go by and, you know, we're jaded. We've got this very strong perspective that may have some truth in it, but also may be very unbalanced, or at least maybe far from where God wants us to be focusing our minds on, being like you quoted Romans 12:2. I mean, that's, we got to have that daily return to, okay, I know what I'm hearing from everybody, and there may even be elements of truth to these things that I'm hearing from everybody, but am I filtering those truths or filtering those non-truths through the Bible and through what is God putting places as a priority in my life? Am I doing that? So if I'm hearing constantly about just, you know, fear and about
jihad,
am I still filtering that though through faith in the Word of God that I have nothing to fear because I'm in Christ, or because that Christ showed compassion on the lost, or that, you know, my perspective is my job according to 1 Timothy 3 to pray for those who are in power and in authority, so that the gospel may spread to the end of the earth. Am I filtering these things through the Word of God constantly and letting that shape my perspective and my focus? Am I keeping my eyes on Jesus as I run the race, not keeping my eyes on Fox News?
What is your view of the Muslims that here in the United States that they don't stand up and rise against the ISIS and the bombings here, terrorism here? Why don't we hear anything from them? Are they scared?
Yeah, that's a tough question, because we would like for it to just be very monolithic. Like, hey, there's some, you know, unified statement that can come out of Islam in America. Well, the difficulty is that, number one, there's not such a unified, you know, it's not just a matter of a leader making a statement or something like that, because they don't have some kind of unified structure from which to do that. So they may be very much opposed to it, but who's listening and who's speaking and who's able to, you know, I mean, it's just almost the dynamics of media and how you get around, how you get that around is just complicated. And so it's not to say that they don't oppose it or that they're not standing up for it. But I mean, in the same sense that people look at us and say, why aren't you doing more to help, you know, the Yazidis on Mount Sinjar? It's like, well, I would, and I do speak out for that. But like right now, I don't control the military, so there's not a whole lot I can do about it. But I do, you know, speak out against that, and I do oppose it, but nobody hears that from me. And a lot of times that's the same way that it is for Muslims. They just have a regular job, and they work from 9 to 5, and they have their perspectives, but nobody's listening. There's not a whole lot that they can do about it.
The media won't go out to, like, the mosque and, like, interview them.
Yeah, exactly. Now, when that does happen, and when you can dig down far enough to find it, you do find that they do speak out about it a lot. And again, Islam in the West is, by and large, very opposed to the methods of Islamic State. Very opposed.
So then what are the Muslims in the East, what do they do in their own country? Do they do anything, stand up against what's happening to themselves? Or?
It depends on the they that you're referring to. If you mean just everyday people, there's nothing they can do. And my experience when I was in Egypt, they hate Islamic State. They think it's the worst thing in the world. And that's true almost everywhere I go throughout the Middle East. Unfortunately, especially in that part of the world, the only people that have power are, and the only people that can do anything about that are the people in power, the president, the dictator, whoever's in power. Other than that, the people can do, they usually don't even have freedom of speech, much less the democratic ability to vote or to do anything about it. So even if 90% or more are opposed, it's all on the one man who happens to be in power at the time, what he does about it. Now, we do see opposition. That's why there's civil war. That's why there's fighting taking place. It's a little bit more complicated than that. There are other reasons, too. But a lot of it, for instance, in Iraq, the Iraqi army is an ally of the West, is an ally of the United States, for instance. And so in the Kurdish region, the Kurds are allies of the United States. The United States supports them and sends troops to train them because of this very issue. They're attempting to oppose the Islamic State. And that's where a lot of the fighting comes from. So there's just not, but it's like beyond that, a lot of the ones from the rest of the world, there's nothing they can do about it. But it's almost just a matter, it's just a difficulty of communication and being able to, really, when you talk about a billion people, it's hard to generalize them in that way. So you're right, there are some that are silent and silently supportive, but there's a very large percentage that are also very opposed, and if they could do something about it, they'd probably do it. Yes, sir.
However, they are supportive of the Quran and what it writes.
That's right.
And what it teaches, and the original leader of that particular religion.
Right, Muhammad.
Muhammad. So, if you go throughout those regions and you say about honor killings and about other things that deal with the Quran, which I believe the book itself is an evil statement from Satan given to this man.
Absolutely.
You have to be aware that these people are, if they're not right now wanting to kill you, at the end times, when things come down to it, and they have a choice, whether it's themselves, because they're Muslim, or those who are against them, they're going to choose to do that. They're going to choose to follow that. So isn't it our responsibility to try and spread the gospel as much as possible, with the understanding that, hey, they probably are not going to remain peaceful.
Yeah.
If they remain in the state they're in.
No, that's a great word. I mean, and that boils down to the value question. Yesterday we talked about whenever we discuss matters and give information, at the end of the day we have to ask the value question. And that is what difference does this make and what should I do about it? How then shall I live? And what does God want me to do with this information? And the answer to that, I think you articulated very well. Our responsibility boils down, plain and simple, to regardless of who they are, how they act, or what the religion does, or even whether or not they're the majority, support or do not support, a certain interpretation of that religion. Our job remains the same, which is we spread the gospel. We share the gospel. We do our role as the church of using our gifts and talents, like we talked about this morning, and in any and every way that we can, we be faithfully laboring. Because that's all that we can do. And that's enough. That's sufficient. That's what God would use to accomplish His final task of redeeming a people for Himself from every tribe, tongue, and nation, from Revelation 7, and that He will use His church to do that. And so I think you're exactly right. I don't know that I can answer, hey, in the end times, here's what the majority of Muslims will do or not do. I don't know the answer to that. But I do know that right now they're lost and they're deceived, and we have the hope of Christ and the hope of eternal life. And to me, that boils it down to the equation for a much simpler thing that we need to know and that we need to do about, and that is how can we be faithful in our part to share the gospel?
That's true. I have kind of regular meetings with a medical doctor who is a Muslim, and I've challenged him and said, you have great medical knowledge. Can you tell me what's in the Quran? Not really. He said, the Quran says what we call it. He said, it is the Holy Quran. It's like it is the Holy Bible. And you don't touch it. But here's a man so well educated who really can't tell me a whole lot about what's in the Quran. He said, I really don't read it. I go to mosque. But then they tell us things.
Yeah.
And kind of like Christianity in a way.
Right.
You know, we need to read God's book more.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And again, that goes back to kind of there is a distinction between the practice of faith in Christianity and the practice of faith in Islam. And that is important to kind of know, I think, as believers. We teach in the practice of Christianity, at least true Christianity that believes in the gospel, that the practice of our faith is that we study the Word of God so that we may know God and know Christ and apply it and walk with Christ in a more deep way. Our faith is dynamic and our relationship is dynamic, meaning it grows and we can learn, we can change, we can apply. We grow in faith, we grow in good works, as Ephesians 2 talks about. Now, Islam is the opposite. It's not a dynamic practice of faith. It's a very, very monolithic, very rigid practice of faith. You do the five pillars and that's it. You don't study the Quran. You don't grow in your relationship with God. You don't grow in your faith in Islam. There's no such thing. You just are a Muslim or you're not. You're either a good one or you're not by whether or not you pray five times a day, keep the pillars of Islam. But you don't study the Quran to learn or to grow or to know God more. The practice of faith is very different. So that is kind of important to know as we are sharing the gospel with them and we're displaying our faith as a genuine faith. As Christ said, they will know you're my disciples by your love. And so they will see how we live out and how we grow and how we learn from in the scriptures and use the scriptures to apply it to our lives. That's what it looks like to be a follower of Christ. And when we're faithful to show them that, that's very foreign to them. That's not something that they understand. So that also then relates to your point, which is this doctor who doesn't have a clue what's in the Quran, but that's also because it doesn't matter. He's not considered a bad Muslim because of that. No Muslim really cares to read and actually understand the Quran because that's not a part of their practice of faith. Like we would say it's important to read and study the Bible.
Yeah, his response on this is what I'm doing. You know, that's always his response to me. In our dialogue together, we're kind of at a point right now, he understands your Christianity is a relationship with the person. Mine is a relationship with rules. I said, that's it exactly. And then you don't measure up, do you? I said, Jesus is my measure. And so I'm just letting God open his mind a little bit. I might mention this today, if you do any kind of reading, a quick read for you, I've come across recently, it's called The Infidel's Complete Guide to Islam. It's written from a Christian perspective. And it's a little bit humorous at times, but you know, he said, who's the, well, I'm the infidel, I need to read it. And so it gives a quick overview of Islam and their thinking.
So one here and then over there.
The underground church that's in the Middle East, now the people there, are they like in hiding also? Do they do the regular things with their family? Because they have to hide it, don't they?
Yeah, yeah. So, it looks a little bit different. Kind of shifts a little bit from certain places to another. Some have a little bit more flexibility and freedom than others do. But there are certain parts where it's extremely, if they are found out that they are believers, they will most likely be killed. And so, one of the very common and challenges right now in church planting in the Middle East is that when Muslims do come to faith in Christ, it is difficult for them to, oftentimes difficult for them to immediately or even at any point turn around and begin sharing their faith again because of that fear. So fear of persecution is like day one of discipleship training and following Christ because it's so, so real and it's so imminent. To them that it's a great challenge. And so that's one of the things that we work on as we teach them, as we try to work through, hey, Jesus said persecution would come. He also said, I will be with you. And we walk through that, we talk through that. And there are sometimes you're right, they don't share it. A lot of times their families don't even know that they've come to know Christ, or at least not for a long time. I don't know, from person to person. And a lot of the ones that I've met, when they come to Christ, they don't. They don't go to mosque anymore. They stop that, and then that does become a red flag to their community around them. Sometimes that's a good thing because that puts them in a place where they can begin to start sharing what's changed about them. Other times it gets them, it's just persecution comes. But the Lord always is sovereign over that, and he uses those things to advance his kingdom. So it's Yeah, it's a real challenge.
When I was in Palestine, I went and visited a number of Muslim families, and there is no church on the block. Everything is in a house. Right. So we would go and we'd meet with the most traditional, with the Abu, elder father figure, you know, in Hebrew. It's kind of like the pastor of the home. He says, but we know others, but others we do not know. So we do not talk openly. But they said it's more of a discovery thing. And they had a Quran for good looks. He says, we also have a Bible over here. So that if anybody comes to our house, he says, we're ready to give an answer.
We hear.
I guess my opinion of the Islamic faith is a little tainted right now, because my husband lost a good friend in San Bernardino. But let's go to talents. You were talking this morning on talents. How can a young Christian, or one that's just not sure, an older Christian, how can they be sure of what their talent would be?
Yeah, great question. I'm glad we're bringing that up. The first answer to that is prayer. I believe that God is a very fair and faithful God, and that He responds to hearts that are open and genuine. I mean, First Chronicles 9:7-9 talks about that His eyes are searching to and fro, looking to strengthen those whose heart is wholly His. And I believe that if we just simply open our hearts, bow our hearts, and say, God, show me what are my gifts and talents that you want me to do a better job of using for you, I believe He's faithful to answer that prayer. And I think that's probably the first and most fundamental answer to that. But the secondly, I think, is just talk to other people around you. Talk to your church and your brothers and sisters in Christ, or your pastor, or someone that may know you well, and say, hey, what do you think? If you're having a difficult time thinking through, or what are my talents that I can use for God, maybe ask others. I think spiritual gifts has a lot to do with that. And somebody said, well, you know, have you ever considered, you're great at, you know, with children, have you ever thought about just doing some children's ministry, things of that nature, or asking those who know you well in the Lord to help you, I think, through that and identify that. And then really, it's just whatever the Lord then uses and brings into your heart as you think through, what are your resources. First of all, I like to think of it in a few different categories. What do I have? So like resources, that can be finances, that could be material possessions, your home, things of that nature. Or it could be like, and then the second one is, what are my influences? Who do you have influence over? What's your sphere of influence look like? Do you have influence in the school system? Well, maybe that would be a stewardship, a talent that you can use. Do you have influence in your business? Maybe you're the owner of a small business. You have influence over your employees. Well, there's a stewardship for you right there. So you ask what your influences are. And then you ask, what are my gifts, or like talents in the regular word we would use? Am I talented? Am I capable? Am I great? Am I a good speaker? How can I use that? Or am I, great at serving? And that's also a matter of, I think, looking through some of those New Testament passages that talk about the gifts of the Spirit and gifts that He's given to the church, and thinking through, where do I fall along that? Do I have a talent in that regard? And just kind of thinking through those things, and then asking others around you, and then praying for them. And I firmly believe God is faithful to show you what your talents are, and then you begin to pray, Lord, how can I use these? I surrender them to you, they're yours. So show me a door, open a door for me to use them. Speak to me and show me how I can do that. I believe He absolutely answers that prayer. But that's a great question. And I think that's a question that every single one of us need to not just ask one time in our life, but all the time, constantly evaluating, Lord, am I using everything you've given me to be a faithful steward?
Don't you think sometimes He wants to use us in a way that we tend to second guess ourselves?
He's
like, you really want me to do that? I am not capable of doing that. Are you sure you want me to do that?
Yeah, amen. Yes.
All the time.
I think that's absolutely true. Well, and that's why prayer is the first thing, because we don't want to trust in our own thoughtfulness to pick what our talents are. We want to make sure we're hearing from God first.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Yes, ma'am.
Over there in the Middle East, are women still consider second-class citizens? And I know they don't have the rights like we do, but when they go to the mosques, even here in America, I wonder, do the women and children have a separated area, or what do the women do?
Yeah, in most mosques, they have a separated area for prayer. So, very, very few places in the world would men and women go to the same room, at least in the mosque, to pray. There would be separate rooms. In a very real sense, yes, women are a second-class citizen in a lot of the Middle East and the more strict Islamic states. They may or may not articulate it that way. No, they may not say it that way. But to varying degrees, the answer is absolutely, and to some places far worse than others. And again, that's a matter of looking specifically into certain areas. But there are some places where, you know, they have basically the same rights and live essentially the same, you know, comfort of lifestyle and freedom and so on and so forth, but just different roles. And in other places, they're very, it's very oppressive, very harshly treated, very restricted rights. Obviously, in the more, basically the more extreme or conservative you get is where you find that. So, yes, ma'am, you had a question earlier.
Yeah, I just wanted to touch back on earlier when, I'm sorry, what were you?
Sandy
brought up the fact that when bombings happen, you don't hear Muslims coming out and talking against it,
right?
And you mentioned how complicated that is, and then you mentioned about your taintedness with the Islamic faith. And I think that's understandable as Americans, because when you say the Islamic faith is mainly a peaceful faith, that is put out primarily by the liberal media.
It is.
Even our president goes out of his way to talk about how peaceful they are. So you would think that when these type of things happen, they should have no problem finding a mosque to go to an interview and have people come out who are Muslim and say, oh, that's tragic. Yes, we are against
right.
that.
Right.
I don't think that's so complicated. If we hear a Christian bombing abortion clinic, even though we may be so against the abortion clinic, we are not going to support that person who bombed that clinic. And you can find plenty of Christians that would come out and speak about that.
Right.
Of course, the media would probably not go and interview those people because their agenda tends to be more liberal. So
right.
I guess my perception is that wouldn't it serve us better to know we are going into, if we're going to witness to these people, we should go in with our eyes open, and I don't think they're primarily peaceful. It's not the same as witnessing to a Buddhist or a Hindu or an atheist in this country. It is a dangerous field, and that how more deep your prayers to know that you might be going into a situation where your life is at risk.
Yeah, that's a really great point. Let me speak a little bit to that. I'll start by making a distinction between the Islamic faith and Muslims, and I think that's probably where a little bit of confusion has taken place. The Islamic faith is not peaceful. The Islamic faith is a horrendous, terrible deception, false truth that is born out of the pit of hell from the mind of Satan himself. I firmly believe that about the Islamic faith. Just like, though, I made the comparison yesterday, every human being who lives on the planet who is not born a saved, sanctified follower of Christ is just as much a son of their father, the devil, when we're born. And we need to be rescued out of the darkness, out of the domain of darkness, into the kingdom of his beloved Son, according to Colossians 1 there. And so the Islamic faith is a terrible, terrible, terrible thing. Muslims are people. And there are many Muslim people who are very violent. And there are many Muslim people who are very peaceful. And that's the distinction that I think is important for us to keep in mind as well. And so when we talk about those statistics, as we did a little bit last night, that's kind of where we were drawing from, is a recognition that, no, the Islamic faith is not a peaceful religion. It's not a good religion. It has nothing good to offer whatsoever. It's absolutely a lie from the pit of hell. But the people are human beings created in the image of God first before they are Muslims. And they are enslaved, they are oppressed, they are deceived by that. And many of those people are very, very peaceful, kind-hearted people. And they need us to expose to them the lies that they are believing through Islam. And so that they can see that there is the truth and the light, which is Christ. And that's the distinction I think that's important for us to keep in mind. And that's the problem with the media, that's the problem with... And it's so it gets a gloss over, a cursory gloss over so quickly that we tend to miss that huge, hugely important distinction between Islam as a faith entity and Muslim people as human beings created in the image of God. Islam is a terrible thing and ought to die immediately, but Muslim people need to be redeemed and saved by hearing the gospel. And most Muslims, the vast, vast majority that I have ever met in my life, which is literally in the thousands, were very peaceful, peaceful people. I mean, I can say it from my own experience because I lived in the Middle East for a number of years. Everyone I met was very kind to me and very peaceful. And they would protect me when I needed to, and they would take care of me, and they would invite me into their home, and they would love me in the human sense of the term, obviously. And so those are Muslim people. But Islam, of course, is something that is extremely deceptive and is not at all peaceful as a religion. But I just say that it's important that as we go into that, and a lot of that has to do with that internal consistency and logic based on reason issue that we talked about earlier. We know that Islam is a terrible thing, and that it has, that there is a violence. I do believe there is inherent violence in the teachings of the Quran and the teachings of Islam. But it doesn't matter to those people. They simply don't believe that. And I can call them out and say, well, you ought to be a jihadist, but what good does that do? I don't want to push them further towards Islam. I just say, well, look, you know, let's just talk about the truth. And I uphold the gospel. We focus the conversation on that. And so I think that, you know, while there are obviously people who would seek to kill us, to kill you, for sharing the gospel with them, you're not very likely, statistically speaking, to find those people here in the U.S. And so I say that to say, practically, if you're going to go out in Texas and try to be a faithful witness, don't shy away from sharing the gospel with a Muslim here just because you're afraid they may be violent and want to harm you. Give that over to the Lord first. Just be a faithful witness and trust Him with that. But statistically speaking, again, unless you are walking around the streets of Saudi Arabia or Yemen, you're not likely to share the gospel with someone who's going to respond with violence to you, just statistically speaking. Go ahead.
However, I would not be doing that same thing in Dearborn, Michigan. There are a lot of places that you can go where you do see that militant type of attitude here in the United States in pockets.
It's not that it's not there. Yeah, I actually just got back from Dearborn a month ago where we have a partnership with a guy who's laboring to reach Yemeni Muslims in Dearborn. It's actually a little suburb called Hamtramck, which is right outside of Dearborn, which is actually a majority population Yemeni. And we did just what you're describing. We actually did go street to street and just meet people and share the gospel. I feel very safe, very comfortable doing that. I'm not trying to talk this up like to say there's no such thing as I'm trying to put a perspective here. You're right, they're there. What difference does that make to me? You know, my job is to go be faithful. And I'm going to share the gospel with them. And I did so in Dearborn. I did so in Egypt. I did so in Djibouti. I did so in Dallas. And I've never met a single Muslim, or probably I would call it in the multi-hundreds that I've shared the gospel with, who has ever been hostile to me. Now, we've got into our debates. Obviously, that's happened all the time. But I've never felt threatened in that sense. But I'm not saying that to say that it doesn't happen. But I am saying that is, I think, a tool of the enemy, that he is neutering the church by instilling fear in us. That, hey, you can't or you shouldn't share the gospel with Muslims because you never know, they might kill you. Well, yeah, it's technically possible they may. And it does happen. Again, I'm not saying it doesn't. What I am saying is that I don't think that's the way of Christ. And I don't think Christ is calling us to a spirit of fear. I think rather he's calling us to a spirit of trusting him and being bold as we share the gospel. Now, if you are going to go to places like Yemen and do it, your methodology would certainly change. But we're not in Yemen.
Very quickly, the Muslim doctor I'm talking with right now, one of the things he told me, he says, I follow Islam. I said, well, I follow Christ. I said, can I tell you about him? He said, no, tell me about your family first. I would like to tell you about my family. And so we reached a little bit. It all has to do with family. And then now I have an opening because we have a common understanding of family. Is that?
Yeah, I mean, because what you're showing is that, again, the numbers 1 billion, 1.5 billion, Muslims are Muslims the vast majority of the time, not because they're convinced of the Islamic theology. They're Muslims simply because they were born into a Muslim family. And a lot of them couldn't care less. Honestly, I've met more Muslim atheists, Muslim practical atheists, than I have Christians that are practical atheists, and there are some of them too. But I met time after time again, everyone's a Muslim, you know, in these, who's born into these families, into this culture. It's more cultural oftentimes than it is anything else. And what they are concerned about is their cultural way of interacting and experiencing truth, rather than built upon a theology that they derive from the Islam.
Yeah, he actually tell me, how do you love your children? And so then he wanted to tell me how he loved his children. You know, and just things like that. And I thought, this is interesting, because he first got in the car and he said, I don't know. I mean, Satan's trying to instill fear in me. Don't do that. Don't share with him. And I said, well, Lord, I'm trusting you. And just let you open the door. And so now he calls on me regularly. Because we have common ground we're talking about, and so he is now, I believe, hopefully I will pick him up tonight in my lift job, you know, and he will be more open than ever, because I pray for him regularly. Yeah, can I address one other quick thing about Sandy's question?
Which one?
They practice something called graded absolutism. I don't know if you're familiar with that. We as Christians, we have absolutes, but it's based in propositional statements from the scripture, like thou shalt not. Mm-hmm. In Islam, they have what's called interpretational absolutism. Whatever the imam or whatever the authority figure says, that becomes truth. Is that?
Yeah, that's fair? Exactly.
So that would concern me. What? That would concern me. What you just said, though, is a lot of them are dealing with cultural, but their culture is what is taught from the Quran by the.
Yeah, but it's his interpretation.
I know, but that's their culture. So if he's telling them it's okay to,
it's okay
to harm you because you mentioned something, that would concern me.
The end justifies the means.
Say that again?
The end justifies the means.
From their perspective.
From their perspective.
I know. I'm just saying, for one thing, I could not go out and witness to a Muslim man, for one thing, because he's not going to take it from a woman. And I would be concerned approaching the wife, because especially if they're more traditional, like you said, women are property, they're second class. I would be concerned trying to witness her and him finding out, then would get her in trouble. And that's kind of where I'm struggling with on that. And as far as the San Bernardino, yeah, we lost a close friend. That is the hurt. But how do I get around the other part of not harming the wife?
Yeah.
If he's finding out I'm trying to witness to her, because their culture and their faith is all one to me.
That's a very important question that you ask. And it's one that I have to wrestle with, we wrestle with, that we actually are doing ministries in the Middle East. We talked about that earlier over this side of the room about, for instance, Jamal, the one that I shared with last night. We shared the gospel with him. He became a follower of Christ, and now he's in danger of his family. He had to flee because of that, and that is very common. And so the first kind of lower level answer to that is, of course, prudence. Prudence led by the Spirit, applying wisdom. You pray through those things, you think through those things, and you talk about, you know, what are ways to be faithful and minimize unnecessary risk. So you think through that, and you try to apply wisdom and prudence. But to the deeper question of, well, why then do it at all? Why is it worth it if you're simply endangering, you know, their life by sharing the gospel with them? Why not leave them Muslims, leave them be, so that they can have a relatively peaceful life without any danger, which is what so many in the world would say to us. It's what politicians would say to you as well. Just let them be. They're Muslims. You know, why convert? Why try to do that? And that would be true. That would be the right answer if Christ were not returning to judge. But the reality is that Jesus is going to return. And it is worth it, because if she does not believe in Christ, she will spend eternity in hell.
You're right.
That's why it's worth it to do that. And it is tough for us, but we have to remind ourselves that it is better for me to get you in some earthly trouble than for me to leave you alone and let you have eternal trouble at the wrath of God. That's not worth it. That's not loving. for me to recognize that truth because I believe the scriptures and to save some earthly trials and tribulation. Didn't Paul say it was worth it when he trusted in Christ, that now everything he thought was great was counted as rubbish? And then 2 Corinthians 4, all the weight and all the trials and all the persecutions is actually nothing more than these temporary, momentary afflictions in light of the eternal weight of glory. That's why we do it anyway. And that's tough. And nobody will understand that unless they understand the reality of the gospel and the return of Christ. That it is worth it for me to get you in trouble by sharing the gospel with you if you choose to believe in Christ, because earthly persecution far outweighs. What good does it do for a man to profit the whole world but to forfeit his soul? Yes?
I have a co-worker who is in Dearborn and lives there, and they're just bidding talk on the news cycle about a no-go zone where you just don't go there because the Muslims rule that area. And you know, when I brought this up to him, I was curious about it. He said that's a lie. That does not exist. There is no such place. There are people walking through that area all the time to try to prove that it's part of what the news is reporting. He told me about it. It's a place where the police can't go and arrest people or laws. Yeah, the three laws. It just fuels my fire about this 24-hour news cycle creating fear in all of us that's well beyond the measure that it needs to be. I mean, I know that there is terrorism that takes place all the time,
right.
But our own news cycle basically is propagating that same type of terror towards us Christians. Because I know that we should be spreading the gospel regardless of what the risk of or is. I mean, I know that from reading anything that apostles have worked on.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, no, I would affirm that.
Does that zone exist?
No, that zone does not exist. I mean, like I said, I just got back from there last month. I spent a week there. I mean, I went specifically to the places where it is majority Arab Muslim because we're doing ministry. So we spend our time in those places. But they're not, and they are majority, but they're not. Officers, there's still other ethnicities, they're not, it's still just a regular place by every other standard. It's just majority Arab Muslims that happen to live there in those communities because they congregate there. I mean, that's true on a smaller scale in the Metroplex. There's where near my church in Irving, there are sections of Irving where the housing is almost all Indian, or it's almost all Arab Muslim. Doesn't change anything about the way the police or government or anything works there. So no, I mean, such a place does not exist when it's put in the U.S., when it's put in, the idea that the police can't go there, the law doesn't apply there, that they're only doing their own internal government, Sharia, and all of that kind of stuff. I've never seen anything like that. No. I'm pretty sure there would be, more recourse. Yeah, I mean, I just don't see that. I don't see that happening either. Let me take a quick minute, and there may be a couple other questions. I don't know what time you want to finish up today, but let me take just a brief minute to share with you just one way, kind of methodologically, that I found to be very helpful for sharing the gospel. And this is true not just for Muslims. This is true for anybody. But a lot of what we're seeing take place around the world, even here in the U.S., in terms of what we call discipleship multiplication or church planting multiplication, new people coming to faith and then growing in faith and then multiplying, a big part of that right now is people that are using stories from the Word of God as kind of the filter or as kind of the icebreaker to introduce people to Christ and the gospel without just only immediately doing one-to-one evangelism, right off the bat. So let me give you a brief example of that. Finding your talents, for instance, could be step one. And that can be a great entry strategy. So you think through, what are my talents? Well, I've got a business, I've got employees who are Muslim, or I've got coworkers that are Muslim. So your entry strategy could be, well, I may see them at work in the break room and start a conversation. That's how you get to that point. But where do you go from there then? Well, one great way is you share stories from the Word of God. And specifically, I'm thinking of stories from the Gospels where Jesus encountered non-believers, and he would do this. He would share stories with them, and I'll give you one brief example that I used a lot that I found to be very, very effective. Jesus told us, so I'll introduce sometimes by saying, hey, I read this story from the Word of God, and I'd like to share it with you today. A lot of times that's really non-threatening, super easy, and it gets you right to the point, which I think is also helpful. And I'll say, I'd like to share with you this story that I read from the Word of God. And he'll say, okay. And I say, Jesus was talking to a crowd of people, and he was specifically talking to some people who were self-righteous and they trusted in their good works. And he said this to them. He said, two people went up to the temple to pray one day. One of them was a very religious man. He went right up to the front of the temple and he raised his hands and he said, oh God, I thank you that I am not a sinner, but that I keep your commandments. I don't steal, I don't commit adultery, and I especially thank you that I'm not like this tax collector over here. And then that tax collector walks in and he is ashamed in his heart, will not even approach the front, and will not raise his head, but he bowed his head and he beat on his chest, and he said, oh God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Jesus looked around at the crowd and said, that man went away justified that day instead of the other. For he who exalts himself will be humbled, but he who humbles himself will be exalted. That was a true story I read from the Word of God today. What do you think about that story? Now see, what I just did there is a very non-threatening way of introducing the elements of the kingdom without just sharing the points or the tenets of the gospel, but in a way that Jesus would do when he was on earth before he would just tell the points of the story of the gospel. He would tell stories like that, helping people to understand the concepts of the kingdom that, hey, it's not about good works. Hey, it's not about being self-righteous. It's actually about being humble before God and asking for forgiveness. Well, that's the response of the gospel right there, wrapped up into a simple story. Well, there's several stories like that in the New Testament. And we found that it can be very effective if you take a story like that and you begin to share it with your Muslim friends. And this could be true for anybody, Muslim or not. And another reason is because if they are intrigued by that, if their hearts are ready to listen to that, you can always say to them, hey, I've got another story. How about we get together tomorrow and I'd like to share with you another one. And then you can pick 7, 8, 9, 10 of these stories. I've got a list of 8 that I use pretty regularly. And then you can come back and you can share story by story of Jesus' encounters where he was offering the kingdom by either way of a parable or an interaction that he had with someone like the Samaritan woman. I mean, the woman at the well, who was a Samaritan. Other Nicodemus or other things, like other stories like that. And then you can, from there, you can go right into sharing your gospel or sharing your testimony when you see that it's appropriate. So that's just, I wanted to offer that to you guys to say that, you know, the point of our conference was this. Kind of in times, people of the end times, it's really getting us thinking, it's getting us, hopefully getting our hearts in order for wanting to be faithful with what God has gifted us. And then I just wanted to introduce that to you as, hey, there's a lot of tools that you can use, and we really just scratched the surface, but that's one tool that you can use. If you say, hey, look, you know, I'm ready to start doing something, taking a step in being a faithful witness, but I don't know how. Well, there's one simple way that you can do that. And I'm sure that Dr. Wilson and your pastor have lots of other evangelistic tools and things like that you can use. But think through that, something like that or something similar. But just have a basic plan, a basic strategy, knowing ahead of time. If you know ahead of time how you're going to share the gospel or what your path is for doing that, you're much more likely to actually be faithful to do so than if you haven't thought about it or you don't know what you would do. So and that's something I would just like to say.
Yep. And Heavenly Father, thank you for the truth of your word that we've heard. Thank you for the seeds that have been sown in our heart. And we trust you with the harvest ahead. And we look forward to where you're going to lead our church, lead our pastor, lead our elders, lead our deacons, and each one of us, not only in our community, but in our individual responsibilities in our everyday life here. Bring Muslim people into our pathway, Lord Jesus, because we want to tell them the truth. Lord, we have a compassion for them because you, Lord Jesus, are in us. We know there is your compassion for them. So help us to understand that those promptings we feel and those desires we have to grow and share our faith, to grow and to reach people who are diverse from us, it comes from you. So we want to take those first steps, Lord Jesus, and obey you in the small things, whether it's simply to say hi or whatever. We'll trust you to open the door and for the results. And it's in your name we pray as you go in your blessing. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much.
Yeah, we had closing music.